Dear students, let us study about the Sierpinski gasket program, which is part of your computer graphics and visualization laboratory. So the question is, we have to develop and implement a recursively a tetrahedron, and we have to go and divide this to form the Sierpinski gasket. The number of recursive steps will be given by the user. So we have to design, develop, and implement this program recursively. So we know that a Sierpinski gasket, it is actually used in mathematics. It is a fractal set with the overall shape of an equilateral triangle, and this equilateral triangle, it will be divided into smaller equilateral triangles by making use of recursion. It is given by the Polish mathematician Wacław Sierpiński. So first we will visualize one Sierpiński gasket, that is the tetrahedron. A Sierpiński gasket or tetrahedron, what we are speaking over here, it is consisting of four points. That means we are having four triangles, three triangles on one triangular base. So this is called as the tetrahedron. First we are going to include our GLUT header file, stdio.h header file, and then we are going to have the array here which will be having three points, that means x, y, z value. By using this point, we are going to build another array which is called as the V array. In this V array, we will be having four rows. These four rows indicate the four values, that is V0, V1, V2 and V3, where every value here, that is every row here, is corresponding to one point with respect to its x, y and z values. So V0 is one point which is having its x value as 0.0, y value as 0.0 and the z value as 1.0. Similarly, V1 is having some value and V2 is also having some values and V3 is also having some values. So these are the initial points what we are going to make use of to construct our tetrahedron. The next function, it is the divide triangle. The divide triangle is a function which is going to accept three points, that is A, B and C. Point A is an array which is consisting of three values, x, y and z. Point B again, it is consisting of x, y and z values. Point C also has x, y and z values. The M is giving the number of subdivisions. So here we are going to take intermediate variables, the point V1, V2, V3. Whenever you look at that point, this particular point is one data structure. It is an array of three points. That means V1 will be having three variables, V2 will be having three variables, and V3 is also having three variables. V1 is one point, and that point is consisting of three values, x, y, and z. Similarly for the V2 as well as for the V3. We will take one variable called as j for the looping. And this function, it will be having a constraint. That is, only when the number of subdivisions, that is the value m, only if it is more than 0. Only if it is more than 0 only, we go for subdividing the triangle. Else, we have to stop the subdividing of the triangle and go for drawing the actual triangle. So in this code, if m is greater than 0, the for loop for the first point, it is run for 3 times. So you can look at this particular picture over here. So we are having A point, B point and the C point. The midpoints V1, V2 and V3, they are constructed by finding the midpoint of the corresponding sides here. So A and B, the midpoint is marked as V1. For the line A and C, the midpoint is marked as V2. For the line B and C, the midpoint is marked as V3. So we are going to compute the values of V1, V2 and V3. And then we are going to call the function called as divide triangle, that is the same function here, which is called recursively. But the change is the divide triangle, which is called now, it will be called for the smaller triangle, which was constructed after going for the subdivision. That means previously the triangle was the bigger one A, B and C. And now I'm having, you can see, the first triangle is given by A, V1 and V2. And we can also observe that we are having the number of subdivisions reduced by 1. Why it is reduced by 1 means because now the bigger triangle what was there, that has been divided into smaller triangles, that is equal to the three triangles what we have over here. So the three recursive functions what we have here, they are corresponding to the each smaller triangle what is constructed by dividing the bigger triangle A, B and C. So here the divide triangle is a recursive function which is going to execute smaller triangles so that we are going to get the smaller subdivisions. If the M value, that is the number of subdivisions, if it is more than 0, then I go for the subdividing. Else, if it has become equal to, there is no further divisions, then we come over here and we come to the else part. That means when the condition fails, if M is greater than 0, only if M is greater than 0, we go for subdividing the triangle. When this condition fails, that means when M is not greater than 0, then we come to this particular part of the code over here and then we go for drawing the actual triangle A, B and C. Depending on from where this particular function has been called in the recursive call, whatever the value of A, B and C are there, those values will be marked here and one small triangle will be drawn. So we know that in OpenGL programming, whenever we have to draw something, we should make use of the glvertex command. Only when we make use of the glvertex command, inside the glbegin and the glend, according to the geometric primitive what we have specified in the glbegin, the appropriate object will be drawn here. So in this particular case, we have the glbegin as the glpolygon. That means one polygon will be constructed. In this case, the polygon is a triangle because we are having 3 points. The GL vertex 3FV of A, B and C, where A is a point which is corresponding to one vertex of the triangle, and this vertex of the triangle, because it is a 3D image, it will be consisting of X, Y and Z value. Similarly, the B point is another vertex of the triangle which will be having its values in terms of X, Y and Z. And similarly for the C, we will be having X, Y and Z values. So the actual drawing is going to happen only when you go for the GL vertex command. The next function is the tetrahedron function. The tetrahedron function is a function which is going to call four divide triangles. These four divide triangles are corresponding to every triangle what we have as part of the tetrahedron. So we know that the tetrahedron or the pyramid or the Sierpinski cascade, it is consisting of four triangles, one on the base and the other three on top of it. So the tetrahedron function, it is going to divide the entire tetrahedron into four smaller triangles again for further subdivisions. So to clearly understand how actually this has been subdivided, we are going to assign different colors to each of these triangular faces. As can be seen over here, the first triangle with its vertices as V0, V1 and V2, it is given the color as red. The picture on the right side is not exactly what is given in the code over here. The picture on the right side is just a visual representation of how a tetrahedron will be seen. And the picture what we have here, that is V0, V1, V2 and V3, this is a tetrahedron and we are having three triangular faces making up one tetrahedron. So V0, V1 and V2 is the first triangular face. V0, V2 and V3 is the second triangular face. V0, V1 and V3, that is the third triangular face. And then we have V1, V2 and V3 as the base. This base is the last triangle what we are considering. So the entire tetrahedron is consisting of four triangles. And these four triangles should be further subdivided by using recursion, what we saw in the previous function. The display function is essential in any OpenGL programming. This display function will be having the statements which are corresponding to how actually the program will be run, the program sub-functions, they will be included in the display. Here in the display, I am making use of a GLClear API. This GLClear API is used for clearing the frame buffer, and then it is also initializing the, or it is also clearing the depth buffer. That means it is clearing the Z buffer. We want to visualize this particular Sierpinski gasket in a three-dimensional view. That is why we require the Z buffer. So this GLClear is clearing the frame buffer and also the Z buffer bit. Then I'm having GL matrix mode. I want to project my Sierpinski gasket onto the display. So to do that, I will be making use of my GL matrix GL projection. This is the constant what I'm going to make use of for projecting the Sierpinski gasket onto the display. So whenever we are having any matrix operations, we have to also make use of the GL load identity so that the previous values will not be affecting the present calculations on the matrix what I am doing. That is why we will be making use of this GL load identity. Tetrahedron is a function which is used here to call the previous function, which is called as the tetrahedron. And the initial value here, it is equal to n. So the number of subdivisions what I want, I am going to make use of over here. And the value I am going to pass into the tetrahedron as the parameter n. So as we all know, the GL flush, it is a function which is used for clearing all the APIs which is present in the buffer. So this ensures that all the APIs are clearly finished off or it is completed before we go to the next functionality of the glut. The main function, it will be consisting of the number of recursive steps what I want in my Sierpinski gasket. So the number of smaller divisions what I want will be given by one variable here called as n. So as usual, the glut init of argc and rv, it is talking about passing the argument count and the argument list to the glut system and initializing the glut by making use of the argument count and the argument list available for this particular program. Then I have the glut init display mode. This API is used for setting some variables with respect to the display. So the first parameter is the first constant what I'm going to make use of. It is the glut single. Glut single indicates that I don't have any animation in my program. That is why I'm going to make use of a single window. When I'm using a single window, I will write here as glut single. The next API what I'm going to make use of, it is the glut RGB. The next constant what I'm going to make use of, that is the glut RGB. Why I'm using glut RGB here? Because I'm going to make use of the RGB color system. The RGB color system is used for displaying the output. And then the third constant what I'm using here, that is the glut depth, which is indicating that you should be having a differentiation between the front points and the points behind the front points so that you will get a view which is like a 3D wherein you can see the closer points will be much better than the background points. There will be a difference in the view when we are having a depth buffer. So to get that view, we are going to include here this glut depth. Now I have one more API called as the glut init window position, and this is the place where my display window will be originally situated on my monitor. So this is 500 by 100. The X value is 500, Y value is 100. Then the window size, the original window size, it will be equal to 500, 500. Of course, we can go for altering it, make it big or small, but initially the window size will be equal to 500 x 500. The label for the output screen for the is given by this 3D Sierpinski gasket. And then I'm going to make use of the GL ortho. This GL ortho will be consisting of 6 parameters. The first 2 parameters are concerned with the x-axis, that is left and right. The left minimum value and the right maximum value, left, right. And then I'm having the next 2 corresponding to the y-axis. It is equal to bottom and top. Bottom means the minimum value with respect to y and the maximum value with respect to y. And then I'm having the z value. Because the Sierpinski gasket here is a 3D Sierpinski gasket, I will make use of the z value also. And the z value will be equal to minus 1 to 1. Then I'll make use of the glut display function to call the display function. This is the display here is a callback function. That means from this main, I'm going to call a event, that is the display event. The display event is included in the glut display function. Then I'm having GL enable. I'm going to enable my depth buffer. And that is why I will be making use of GL depth test. This is the symbolic constant what you have to use whenever you want to enable the Z buffer. Then GL clear color. I am going to clear the display window to white color. The last value is the alpha value. The alpha value is not significant over here. It is not working here because the alpha value we should always be combined with the materialistic properties and by using other APIs. So in this case, it will not make any difference. The alpha stands for transparent or opaque, but in this case, it will not make any difference. So as usual, the last statement here, it is the glut main loop. The glut main loop ensures that all the APIs will be completed in the program. So we know that the OpenGL program will be in an infinite loop. The loop will close only when all the functions are completed, and this is ensured by the glut main loop. So here we can see we have the Sierpinski gasket with 0 divisions, 1 division, 2 division, 3 division and 4 division. So the first one is the Sierpinski gasket with 0 number of subdivisions. And then I'm having 1 subdivision. You can see here the upright triangle. The upright triangle means we will be having the base at the bottom, the baseline at the bottom, and the tip of the triangle will be at the top. So this type of triangle is called as the upright triangle. This upright triangle, it will be divided into small 4 triangles here, where we are having the middle one as the triangle which is facing downwards. So this is the number of subdivisions is equal to 1. When I'm going to divide the bigger triangle into 1 small triangle which is facing to the bottom, and where this division is going to lead to another set of 3 triangles which are upright. So then in the next picture you can see here we can have the number of subdivisions as 2. How it is the number of subdivisions as 2? The first big upright triangle has been divided in the middle by making use of the triangular division over here, which is bottom faced. That means it is facing to the bottom. And then again, the next upright triangles, what are there? 3 upright triangles here. Again, they are subdivided to give smaller subdivisions. So like this, we will be having 3 subdivisions and 4 subdivisions. This is done only for the one triangular face. This has to be repeated for all the triangular faces in this program. This is a 3D view of the 3D Sierpinski gasket, wherein we are having 4 subdivisions, 5 subdivisions and 6 subdivisions. That means on every triangle face, the equilateral triangle, it is going to be divided for 4 times, 5 times and 6 times respectively. So in this particular picture over here, you can see the general flow of the Sierpinski gasket program. This program is consisting of the main function. The main function is going to call the display function. The display function in turn calls a tetrahedron function. The tetrahedron function is going to call 4 divide triangle functions, because the tetrahedron is consisting of 4 triangles, 1 on the base and 3 on top of it. So 4 divide triangles, and every divide triangle in turn execute recursively, and then it is going to call divide triangle again until we can no more divide the triangle. Once we cannot divide the triangle, at that place we are going to call the GL polygon and construct one triangle, which is the smaller triangle. So this happens on all 4 faces of the tetrahedron. So this is the 3D Sierpinski gasket view. So here we are having the number of subdivisions. What we have here, it is equal to 5. So you can see on every triangular face, we are going to have the subdivisions, so that when you go on carve out the inner triangles, this is the view what you are going to get. So when we run the program on the system, this is the actual output what I am getting. And here the number of subdivisions what I am considering is 2. You can observe here on the Sierpinski gasket here, this is the inner triangle, and then I have the next triangle. So here we are having 2 subdivisions, and these 2 subdivisions are happening on all the triangular faces. So this is when we are having the Sierpinski gasket with 3 subdivisions. These 3 subdivisions are happening on each triangular faces. This is the output what we are getting when we go for the number of subdivisions as 4. So this is my acknowledgement. This concludes the program. Thank you. If we are going to give the number of divisions as 2, then the output, the Sierpinski gasket will be having the output like this. So in this case, first what we are going to do, we are going to take the center point of each of these edges over here, and then I am going to get 1 division. Then again I am going to take the individual triangles over here, and then find the midpoint and take their divisions. So this is having number of subdivisions as 2. That means I have the midpoint 1 division, and also inside that I have 1 more subdivision. So this is called as the Sierpinski gasket in which I am having the divisions as 2. So we have to go for constructing this on every face. That means totally I will be having 4. For a pyramid there will be 4 faces, no? So here we have the black face, then I have the dark blue color, then I have the red color, and behind this, which is not visible, that is a green color. So on all the 4 faces, the same logic will be executed. So as you go on increasing the number of subdivisions, you will see that this will be having multiple number of small triangles.